This is a community-supported legal education channel. Find out how you can support our mission at the links in the description below.
Recently, a situation occurred with Congress that I thought you might find interesting. Emily Murphy, the administrator of the General Services Administration, is supposed to be facilitating the transition from the Trump administration to the Biden administration, and she has refused to do so. This has led to the House of Representatives subpoenaing her for her testimony regarding why she's not facilitating the transition as she's supposed to be. On November 23rd, Congress sent her a letter requesting her testimony or explanation and denying her the ability to send someone in her stead or to postpone the hearing and therefore the transition yet another week. And while the letter did not directly threaten contempt of Congress, I thought this would be a great opportunity to go over something that we haven't really seen before, which is what is a congressional chamber, the House or the Senate, supposed to do when a witness defies a subpoena or requests to testify? What power does Congress have to enforce their subpoena power? But Ms. Murphy has chosen not to test Congress's subpoena power, and instead she has issued a letter stating that she will begin the transition process now. So I thought this would be a great opportunity to explore the last time that someone was fully held in contempt of Congress and the dramatic situation that arose with William McCracken, the first aviation regulator back in the 1930s, who was found in contempt of Congress and imprisoned for 10 days, but not all at once. William P. McCracken Jr. was born in Chicago, Illinois, the son of a physician, in 1888. A visionary and pioneer in aviation law, McCracken earned a Ph.B. degree in philosophy from the University of Chicago in 1909. He continued at the same institution, receiving his Juris Doctor, or law degree, in 1911. Immediately after being admitted to the bar, he established a law practice in Chicago and was well on his way to carving out a predictably comfortable and privileged life, but World War I interrupted the expected narrative of McCracken's personal history. He enlisted in the U.S. Air Service, where he received flight training, an experience that altered his life forever and awakened a lifelong passion for aviation and aeronautics. Eventually, he served as a flight instructor himself and remained on that assignment until the war ended. After the war, he returned to his law practice in Chicago and began to lay the foundation for a distinguished career. He became the Assistant Attorney General for Illinois in 1983 and later the Assistant State Attorney of Cook County in 1924. He was a member of the American Bar Association and served as its secretary from 1925 to 36. He served on the Committee on Aeronautical Law from 1920 to 1926, and he was a member of the Board of Governors of the National Aeronautical Association from 1922 to 1926. Later, the Air Commerce Act of 1926 instructed the Secretary of Commerce to foster air commerce, designate and establish airways, establish, operate, and maintain aids to air navigation, arrange for research and development to improve such aids, license pilots, issue airworthiness certificates, and investigate accidents. So much of the industry was tied to commerce, mail delivery, and commercial air travel, it made sense to locate the government's new aeronautics branch within the Department of Commerce. McCracken became the first Assistant Secretary of Commerce for Aeronautics, reporting directly to Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover, the future U.S. President. After leaving office as the first Assistant Secretary of Commerce for Aeronautics in October 1929, McCracken returned to private law practice, where he represented several of the major airlines as a private attorney. In April 1930, Congress passed the McNary-Waters Act and gave the Postmaster General broad regulatory control over the award of contract mail routes. Postmaster General Walter Brown asked McCracken to chair a series of meetings, popularly known as the Spoils Conference, to decide which airlines would be awarded air mail routes. The majority of the airmail contracts went to three major airlines, Boeing, Transcontinental, and Robertson. Many of the smaller airline operators complained that the contracts had been unjustly awarded to larger airlines. To address those concerns, Senator Hugo Black, later a U.S. Supreme Court justice, led an investigation committee that called into question the legality of Postmaster Brown's decisions. On Thursday, February 1, 1934, Black's committee issued a subpoena for McCracken's records regarding the air mail contracts. McCracken refused to produce files, citing attorney-client privilege unless his clients waived the privilege. Black argued that McCracken represented the airline industry more as a lobbyist and not an attorney, and therefore he could not claim attorney-client privilege. When McCracken did not turn over the documents, Black held him in contempt of Congress and ordered Senate Sergeant-at-Arms Chelsea Journey to arrest him. Journey arrested McCracken in his office in the National Press Building the following day. He took his prisoner back to the Senate and read the order of arrest with the press in attendance. McCracken remained free on the personal bond of his attorney, Frank J. Hogan, but was required to appear before the Senate on Monday, February 5th. In the meantime, McCracken's law office had contacted their clients and asked for waivers to provide pertinent files to the committee. All provided those waivers within a week. While Black's committee continued its hearing over the weekend, McCracken sat in a private Senate gallery watching the proceedings. On Sunday, Northwest Airways Vice President L.C. Britton, Western Air Express President Harris Hanshew, and his secretary Gilbert Given testified before the committee. Britton admitted he had gone to McCracken's office with the permission of McCracken's partner and had destroyed some of his papers. Gilbert Given also admitted to removing personal correspondence from McCracken's files. Fearing more files would be taken from McCracken's law office, Black ordered Chelsea Journey, Sergeant-at-Arms, to take into custody all of the files in McCracken's office relating to the mail contracts. Journey removed 5 file cabinets from McCracken's office and placed them under guard by Department of Justice agents in the Senate caucus room. In a search of the building's trash room, Journey discovered a bag of trash from McCracken's office with torn-up correspondence. As it turned out, Britton tore up 47 documents while in McCracken's office and threw them in the office wastebasket. Pieced back together by committee staffers, 43 of those documents dealt directly with aviation matters and air mail subsidies. On Monday, February 5th, the Senate ordered a postponement of McCracken's appearance until Friday, since the Senate needed to debate an important appropriations bill. When Black's committee reconvened on Friday, February 9th, Vice President Garner received a letter from McCracken. McCracken wrote that he would not appear on the grounds that the Senate's functions were legislative and not judicial. The court, he said, quote, has held that punishment for completed acts is a judicial function. To appear at the bar of the Senate would be to give assent to the powers that do not constitutionally belong to it. He continued that appearing at the Senate trial would be, quote, a violation of the rights guaranteed to me by the Constitution. The Senate quickly adopted a resolution ordering McCracken to be arrested and brought before the bar of the Senate for trial. The bench warrant for his arrest, signed by Vice President Garner, called for McCracken's appearance, dead or alive. Journey left immediately to arrest McCracken at his home, but did not find him at his home, in his office, or in his attorney's office. After an overnight pause, the hunt for McCracken continued Saturday morning. On Saturday morning, with reporters camped on her lawn, McCracken's wife said she did not know the whereabouts of her husband. When asked if he had been home Friday night, she responded, "I haven't any idea." McCracken had gone into hiding while his attorney, Frank Hogan, sought a means to protect his client. Hogan wanted to have McCracken arrested in the D.C. Supreme Court so that a writ of habeas corpus could be signed before McCracken could be taken before the Senate. Such a writ would require McCracken be brought before a judge or court before being detained or imprisoned by the Senate. With the location of McCracken unknown, the Senate postponed a decision in the contempt proceedings until Tuesday. Once the Senate adjourned for the weekend, McCracken appeared at Journey's apartment on Saturday evening and tried to turn himself in. Journey's maid allowed McCracken into the apartment, where a surprised Sergeant-at-Arms Journey informed McCracken that he did not have the Senate's arrest warrant in his possession. He would not have it until Monday at noon when he went back into his office. McCracken refused to leave the residence. Apparently not knowing Journey did not have the writ with him, Hogan immediately went to the home of Justice Daniel O'Donohue, a justice in the DC Supreme Court, and said his client had been placed under arrest by the Senate. In applying for the writ, Hogan explained that the Senate, by attempting to bring his client before its bar to punish him, was an invasion by the legislative branch of judicial functions and was an infringement on the rights of McCracken as a citizen. Hogan obtained the writ, returnable Monday at 10 a.m. in the District of Columbia Supreme Court. O'Donohue sent Deputy Marshal John Clarkson to Journey's home with the writ. Clarkson demanded Journey release McCracken to his custody. Journey replied he could not hand McCracken over because he had not arrested him. He did not plan to do that until the Senate was back in session on Monday. McCracken, however, told Clarkson he believed he was, indeed, in custody and planned to stay with Journey as his prisoner. As one reporter explained, the Senate wanted McCracken to surrender while it was in session so that he could be hurried to trial. McCracken wanted to surrender when the Senate was not in session so that he could be freed upon a writ of habeas corpus. A writ of habeas corpus is a Latin phrase meaning, we a court command that you have the body of the detainee brought before us, and is a recourse in law through which a person can report an unlawful detention or imprisonment to a court and request that the court order the custodian of the person, usually the prison officials, to bring the prisoner to court to determine whether the detention is lawful. McCracken, insisting he was under arrest, refused to leave the Journey apartment. As one journalist reported, a flabbergasted Mrs. Journey excitedly put her five-room apartment in order for her unexpected weekend guest. McCracken, in a dark blue business suit, said he was sorry to bother her, but since her husband had arrested him, he felt honor-bound to stay the night, tomorrow, and until 10 o'clock Monday morning, when Journey returned to his Senate office for the writ. Journey later reported, I said nothing about kicking him out because I thought that was not the dignified thing to do. Journey and McCracken, longtime friends, posed for press photographs before retiring for the night. On Sunday, Journey informed McCracken he needed to meet with Senator Black and United States Attorney Leslie Garnett in the Senate office building. Still claiming he was Journey's prisoner, McCracken walked to the office building with Journey. McCracken waited outside the office while Journey attended his meeting. Afterwards, McCracken left the building with his jailer. They made small talk for a while on the sidewalk. Journey said, "Well, Bill, as you know, you are not under arrest. I have never read the warrant to you, and your appearance at my apartment last night, while we were glad to see you, did not constitute a surrender to arrest." Journey suddenly jumped into Garnett's car and locked the doors as the car sped off, leaving McCracken on the sidewalk. Once home, Journey locked his apartment door and instructed his maid not to let anyone in. As a reporter explained, tongue-in-cheek, McCracken disappeared into the night and all hands refused to say where he had gone. It was deemed likely that he might be prowling through Capitol Park, looking and looking for the fugitive jailer. At 10 a.m. on Monday, Garnett asked Judge O'Donohue to withdraw the writ of habeas corpus. He argued that the writ was invalid because McCracken had not been legally arrested when he issued it. Hogan argued that McCracken had presented himself for arrest in good faith and said the judge's decision would make it unsafe for any citizen to bring a question of law before the court. The judge agreed with Garnett and ordered McCracken to pay a fine of $100 for contempt of district court or serve 24 hours in jail. McCracken paid the fine, after which Journey pulled out the Senate arrest warrant, took him into custody, and escorted him to the Senate bar, accompanied by several Capitol Police officers. With McCracken officially under Senate arrest, O'Donohue immediately issued a second writ of habeas corpus. As long as McCracken was in the Senate chamber, however, the writ could not be delivered. The Senate immediately began the trial of McCracken and his co-defendants on Monday afternoon. Black, however, soon postponed the trial until the next morning because the senators were needed on the Senate floor. Once Journey left the Senate chambers with McCracken, two deputy marshals, John Clarkson and Stephen Callahan, forced their way through a throng of spectators, newspaper reporters, and photographers and served the new writ of habeas corpus in Journey's office. The habeas corpus writ required Journey to bring McCracken back to O'Donohue's chambers. Journey complied, and when he and his prisoner arrived, O'Donohue said he would rule on the legality of McCracken's arrest, giving each side 15 minutes to prepare. Mr. Hogan's defense lasted approximately an hour. District Attorney Garnett, representing the Senate, laid out his case in 15 minutes. The judge ruled immediately the arrest was legal and dismissed his writ. Journey then took McCracken under arrest to the Willard Hotel for the night. As the Chicago Tribune reported on the day's events, William P. McCracken slept tonight in Senate custody, slept in the watchful care of his trusty bunkmate, Sergeant-at-Arms Chelsea W. Journey, following a day of such legal and legislative burlesque as seldom if ever has graced the pages of congressional or court records. As the country waited for McCracken's trial to begin on Tuesday, February 14th, many contemplated what the outcome might be. Reporters pointed out that McCracken's case is complicated by the fact that resentment among the senators is high as a result of the tactics on the part of himself and Frank J. Hogan, his counsel. The whirligig of the last few days' events, which found McCracken in and out of arrest and playing tag with the sergeant at arms, had caused more than one senator to favor making an example of McCracken. When the trial resumed on February 14th, Hogan argued that the charges against his client be dropped. He claimed that the Senate did not have jurisdiction to try and convict his client because McCracken had purged himself of all charges when he turned over the required documents to Congress. The Senate went into closed session to deliberate the contempt charges against McCracken and his co-defendants, Harris Hanshew, Gilbert Given, and Elsie Britton. The Senate adjourned for the day without a decision. Journey took McCracken back to the Willard Hotel for the night. The other defendants were allowed to return home until the Senate met again the following day. The Senate handed down its decision in open session on February 15th. It found McCracken and Britton guilty of contempt of Congress and acquitted Hanshew and Given. The votes to convict McCracken and Britton followed party lines, with most Republicans voting in favor of convictions and all Democrats and progressive Republicans voting against. The Senate sentenced McCracken and Britton to 10 days in the District of Columbia jail. Britton opted not to appeal and began serving his 10-day jail sentence, saying he had lost his job with the airline company and did not have the money to post bond. McCracken was released on a $5,000 bond pending appeal. McCracken appealed his conviction to the District of Columbia Court of Appeals, who, on July 9, 1934, reversed the earlier decision of the D.C. Supreme Court. The appeals court ruled, quote, "The United States Senate has no power to sentence anyone for past contempt." On September 1, 1934, U.S. Attorney Garnett asked the U.S. Supreme Court to review the Court of Appeals decision. In his petition, Garnett said, "The case involves a question of much importance affecting the power and authority of the Senate of the United States to deal with a contumacious witness." On February 4, 1935, the Supreme Court ruled in the Senate's favor, stating Congress had the right to punish for contempt. In its unanimous decision, the justices gave McCracken 25 days to appeal its decision. It confirmed the right of Congress to investigate, subpoena witnesses and evidence, and punish anyone who willingly thwarts a congressional committee's search for facts. Deciding not to ask for further review of the case, on February 26, 1936, McCracken began serving his 10-day sentence in the District of Columbia jail. And so here is that case, Journey v. McCracken, before the U.S. Supreme Court, argued in January of 1935 and decided February 4, 1935. Justice Brandeis delivered the opinion of the court. "This petition for a writ of habeas corpus was brought in the Supreme Court of the District of Columbia by William P. McCracken, Jr. against Chelsea W. Journey, the Sergeant-at-Arms of the Senate of the United States. The writ issued, the body of the petitioner was produced before that court, and the case was then heard on demurrer to the petition. The trial court discharged the writ and dismissed the petition," meaning the contempt charge was upheld. "The Court of Appeals, two justices dissenting, reversed that judgment and remanded the case to the Supreme Court of D.C. with directions to discharge the prisoner from custody," so they reversed. "This court, the U.S. Supreme Court, granted certiorari because of the importance of the question presented. The petition alleges that McCracken was, on February 12, 1934, arrested and is held under a warrant issued on February 9th, 1934, after McCracken had respectfully declined to appear before the bar of the Senate in response to a citation served upon him pursuant to Resolution 172 adopted by the Senate on February 5, 1934. The resolution provides, quote, resolved that the President of the Senate issue a citation directing William P. McCracken Jr., L.H. Britton, Gilbert Given, and Harris Hanshoe to show cause why they should not be punished for contempt of the Senate on account of the destruction and removal of certain papers, files, and memorandums from the files of William P. McCracken Jr. after a subpoena had been served upon McCracken, as shown by the report of the Special Senate Committee investigating ocean and airmail contracts. It is conceded that the Senate was engaged in an inquiry, which it had the constitutional power to make, that the committee had authority to require the production of papers as a necessary incident of the power of legislation, and that the Senate had the power to coerce their production by means of arrest. No question is raised as to the propriety of the scope of the subpoena, or as to the regularity of any of the proceedings which preceded the arrest. The claim of privilege hereinafter referred to is no longer at issue. Remember, everybody waived the attorney-client privilege. McCracken's sole contention is that the Senate was without power to arrest him with a view to punishing him, because the act complained of, the alleged destruction and removal of the papers after service of the subpoena, was the past commission of a completed act which, prior to the arrest and the proceedings to punish, had reached such a stage of finality that it could no longer affect the proceedings of the Senate or any committee thereof, and which, and the effects of which, had been undone long before the arrest. The petition occupies, with exhibits, 100 pages of the printed record in this court, but the only additional averments essential to this decision of the question presented are, in substance, these. The Senate had appointed the special committee to make, quote, a full, complete, and detailed inquiry into all existing contracts entered into by the Postmaster General for the carriage of air mail and ocean mail. McCracken had been served on January 31, 1934, with a subpoena to appear before the committee and to bring all books of account and papers relating to air, mail, and ocean contracts. The witness appeared on that day, stated that he has a lawyer, a member of the firm of McCracken and Lee, with offices in this district, that he was ready to produce all papers which he lawfully could, but that many of those in his possession were privileged communications between himself and corporations or individuals for whom he had acted as attorney, that he could not lawfully produce such papers without the client first having waived the privilege, and that, unless he secured such a waiver, he must exercise his own judgment as to what papers were within the privilege. He gave, however, to the committee the names of these clients, and stated the character of services rendered for each, and, at the suggestion of the committee, telegraphed to each, asking whether consent to disclose confidential communications would be given. From some of the clients, he secured immediately unconditional consent, and on February 1st produced all the papers related to the business of the clients who had so consented. On February 2nd, before the committee had decided whether the production of all the papers should be compelled despite the claim of privilege, McCracken again appeared and testified as follows. On February 1st, he personally permitted Given, a representative of Western Air Express, to examine, without supervision, the files containing papers concerning that company, and authorized him to take, therefrom, papers which did not relate to airmail contracts. Given, in fact, took some papers which did relate to airmail contracts. On that same day, Britton, Vice President of Northwest Airways, without McCracken's knowledge, requested and received from his partner, Lee, permission to examine the files relating to that company's business and to remove therefrom some papers stated by Britton to have been dictated by him in Lee's office and to be wholly personal and unrelated to matters under investigation by the committee. Britton removed from the files some papers, took them to his office, and, with a view to destroying them, tore them into pieces and threw the pieces into the waste paper basket. Upon the conclusion of McCracken's testimony on February 2nd, the committee decided that none of the papers in his possession could be withheld under the claim of privilege. Later that day, McCracken received from the rest of his clients waivers of their privilege, and thereupon promptly made available to the committee all the papers then remaining in the files. On February 3rd, after a request therefore by McCracken, Given restored to the files what he stated were all the papers taken by him. The petition does not allege that any of the papers taken by Britain were later produced. It avers that, prior to the adoption of the citation for contempt under Resolution 172, McCracken had produced and delivered to the Senate of the United States, to the best of his ability, knowledge, and belief, every paper of every kind and description in his possession or under his control relating in any way to airmail and ocean mail contracts, and that on February 5th, 1934, all of said papers were turned over and delivered to said committee, and since that date they have been and they are now in the possession of said committee. First, the main contention of McCracken is that the so-called power to punish for contempt may never be exerted in the case of a private citizen solely as punishment. The argument is that the power may be used by the legislative body merely as a means of removing an existing obstruction to the performance of its duties, that the power to punish ceases as soon as the obstruction has been removed, or its removal has become impossible, and hence that there is no power to punish a witness who, having been requested to produce papers, destroys them after service of the subpoena. The contention rests upon a misconception of the limitations upon the power of the Houses of Congress to punish for contempt. It is true that the scope of the power is narrow. No act is so punishable unless it is of a nature to obstruct the performance of the duties of the legislature. There may be a lack of power because, as the Kilbourne v. Thompson case says, there was no legislative duty to be performed, or because, as the Marshall v. Gordon case says, the act complained of is deemed not to be of a character to obstruct the legislative process. But where the offending act was of a nature to obstruct the legislative process, the fact that the obstruction has since been removed, or that its removal has become impossible, is without legal significance. The power to punish a private citizen for a past and completed act was exerted by Congress as early as 1795, and since then it has been exercised on several occasions. In 1975, Robert Randall and Charles Whitney were taken into custody by the House of Representatives on December 28th on charges of attempting to bribe some of its members. Whitney was discharged in January of 1976 before trial. Randall, however, on January 6th, was found guilty of contempt and a breach of the privileges of the House, was reprimanded by the Speaker, and was committed to the custody of the Sergeant-at-Arms until further order of the House. On January 13th, his petition to be discharged from custody was granted upon payment of fees. And in 1832, Samuel Houston, or Houston, having been arrested and tried by the House of Representatives for assaulting a member, was reprimanded and discharged on payment of fees. In 1865, A.P. Field was taken into custody for assaulting a member and was reprimanded by the Speaker. So too Charles C. Glover in 1913. In 1870, Patrick Wood, for a similar offense, was imprisoned for 3 months by an order of the House. I'm seeing a pattern here. A lot of people get in trouble for assaulting members of Congress. I don't condone it, but I understand. In 1795, Senator James Gunn, whose challenge of a member of the House was considered a breach of privilege, escaped with an apology. This power was asserted before the Revolution by the colonial assemblies in imitation of the British House of Commons, and afterwards by the Continental Congress by state legislative bodies. In Anderson v. Dunn, decided in 1821, it was held that the House had the power to punish a private citizen for an attempt to bribe a member. No case has been found in which the exertion of the power to punish for contempt has been successfully challenged on the ground that, before punishment, the offending act had been consummated and that the obstruction suffered was irremediable. The statements in the opinion in Marshall v. Gordon above, upon which McCracken relies, must be read in the light of the particular facts. It was there recognized that the only jurisdictional test to be applied by the court is the character of the offense, and that the continuance of the obstruction or the likelihood of its repetition are considerations for the discretion of the legislators in meting out the punishment. Here, we are concerned not with an extension of congressional privilege, but with a vindication of the established and essential privilege of requiring the production of evidence. For this purpose, the power to punish for a past contempt is an appropriate means. The apprehensions expressed from time to time in congressional debates in opposition to particular exercises of the contempt power concerned not the power to punish as such, but the broad undefined privileges which it was believed might find sanction in that power. The ground for such fears has since been effectively removed by the decisions of this court, which hold that assertions of congressional privilege are subject to judicial review, and that the power to punish for contempt may not be extended to slanderous attacks which present no immediate obstruction to legislative processes. Second, the power of either House of Congress to punish for contempt was not impaired by the enactment in 1857 of the statute making refusal to answer or to produce papers before either House or one of its committees a misdemeanor. The statute was enacted not because the power of the House to punish for past contempt was doubted, but because imprisonment limited to the duration of the session was not considered sufficiently drastic a punishment for contumacious witnesses. That the purpose of the statute was merely to supplement the power of contempt by providing for additional punishments was recognized in Re Chapman. We grant that Congress could not divest itself or either of its houses of the essential and inherent power to punish for contempt in cases to which the power of either house was properly extended. But because Congress, by the Act of 1857, sought to aid each of the houses in discharge of its constitutional functions, it does not follow that any delegation of the power in each to punish for contempt was involved, and the statute is not open to objection on that account. Punishment, purely as such, through contempt proceedings, legislative or judicial, is not precluded because punishment may also be inflicted for the same act as a statutory offense. As was said in Re Chapman, the same act may be an offense against one jurisdiction and an offense against another, and indictable statutory offenses may be punished as such, while the offenders may likewise be subject to punishment for the same act as contempts, the two being capable of standing together. Third, McCracken contends that he is not punishable for contempt because the obstruction, if any, which he caused to the legislative process has been entirely removed and its evil effects undone before the contempt proceedings were instituted. He points to the allegations in the petition for habeas corpus that he had surrendered all papers in his possession, that he was ready and willing to give any additional testimony which the committee might require, and that he had secured the return of the papers taken from the files by Given with his permission, and that he was in no way responsible for the removal and destruction of the papers by Britain. This contention goes to the question of guilt, not to that of the jurisdiction of the Senate. The contempt with which McCracken is charged is, quote, the destruction and removal of certain papers. Whether he is guilty and whether he has so far purged himself of contempt, that he does not now deserve punishment, are questions which the Senate proposes to try. The respondent to the petition did not, by demurring, transfer to the court the decision of those questions. The sole function of the writ of habeas corpus is to have the court decide whether the Senate has jurisdiction to make the determination which it proposes. The judgment of the Court of Appeals is reversed, and that of the Supreme Court of the District should be affirmed. And so that is how William P. McCracken got to be held in contempt of the Senate 2 or so years after the incidents occurred. And as we saw, he then turned himself in February of 1936 and served his 10-day jail sentence. So Emily Murphy was correct in conceding that the president-elect deserves to begin his transition process, just like any other transition process. One of the hallmarks of the greatness of the United States and other democratic civilizations is the peaceful transfer of power from one administration to the other. In the past, these transitions have been peaceful and constructive and have benefited the country and our standing on the world stage. To withhold the transition from one administration to the other shows some kind of contempt for not just the transition process, but for the Constitution, the democratic process through which we all create a greater civilization. So let me know what you think in the comments below. I think this was the right thing for Emily Murphy to do. I think it was not correct for her to withhold the transition process out of some kind of contempt for the new administration. And only if there really was a true contest about the election, would there be any reason to withhold the transition? And as we saw from many, many, many court cases brought by the current administration, there was no evidence of anything other than a fair and legal election process. Let me know what you think in the comments below. So that's our show. Thanks for joining me. I'm Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney. This is Lawful Masses, your favorite legal news and education program here on YouTube, on Twitch, and on Floatplane. We are community supported by our patreon.com/LJFrench supporters, by our sponsus.com/law supporters, by our YouTube members, and our Floatplane subscribers. Thank you very much in the month of November to our $50 plus supporters, Joe Tyson, Wes Delge, Citizen of the Sovereign, John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Evie, Kyle Mudrock, Spirit Bear, Andy, Benjamin Hightoff, Goliath Cleric, Ugly Grill, Shiloh T, Rudolph Bescherer Jr., Oscar the Prophet, Jay Dixon, Hot Grills in Your Area, Brandon Abel, Torpedon, Cassandra Curran, Mayor of Titty City, Shadow Tycho, RDH Dragon, Earthbound Star, and No Copyright Violation Intended. The $5 plus supporters are scrolling on the LED panel behind me. All of you are crawling on the screen in front of me. I love you all. I will see you in the videos that drop. Bye.